State Representative Kate Klunk, and welcome to my legislative report. Today, I am in the district, and I will take you on a tour of Hanover's Brewers. First up, we are here at Aldous Brewing Company with the founder of Aldous, Jason Mininger. Jason, thank you so much for joining us today and letting us tour your beautiful facility.
No problem, glad to have you.
Well, thank you. So, Aldous, what is in the name Aldous?
That is a question that we get asked all the time. Short story is, Aldous Minucius was a 15th century Venetian printer. And people will ask, well, what does that have to do with craft beer? Nothing, but the link that we make is best known for bringing quality literature to the masses.
Okay.
Specifically, he created the italic font, so when he printed books, you could fit more words per page, more lines per page, reducing the amount of paper needed. He found a way to print on cheap vellum and found a way to bring Greek literature to the masses, because even though the printing press had been created in the 15th century, unless you were part of the church or part of the government, you couldn't afford a book.
So he was pretty much the modern day creator of the paperback.
Okay,
yeah. So that's he brought literature to the masses. So with Aldous, you're trying to bring beer to the masses?
Craft beer to the masses. The connection that we make is he didn't change the literature, he made it accessible to people. It was still the same quality literature that was written. He didn't truncate it, it wasn't abridged, it was just what needed to be out there in people's hands. We're trying to do the same thing with craft beer, and the fact that we work very hard to make sure the beer is accessible by whether you're the biggest beer drinker in the world or someone who doesn't really have any kind of palate for craft beer, you should be able to come in here and try one of the beers and understand what we're trying to do.
You are the only local brewer here in the Hanover area that is a distributing brewery. Can you talk a little bit about that and why you're starting to focus on that distribution portion of the business?
Wholesale beer was always kind of our mission here. We really thought we had a great product, specifically with the first beer that Ryan and I brewed, which was the Blonde. We really thought it needed to be out there in people's hands. We see it as a great stepping stone beer into the world of craft beer, as it's really well balanced, and we just saw a market for it. In order to do that, you have to have a production facility, because you can't bottle those one at a time in your basement and expect to make any money. So when we actually built the facility out, the whole purpose was production. And now as we're getting into wholesale, the dream's sort of coming to fruition, and you know, our bottling line is running constantly, and the fermenters are constantly full, so that's sort of the plan. And the brew pub really kind of was born from the brewery, because as we're building the brewery, a billion people asked us, are you gonna have a brew pub? And we hadn't had a plan for that yet. And so this sort of became, this was actually a secondary plan to the whole Aldous plan.
Well, I know I have been here before and you have some amazing beers, but my favorite is the American Blonde. And I find the American Blonde to be very accessible and bringing a very simple, good tasting beer to the masses. So can you talk a little bit about the American Blonde and that being your flagship beer here at Aldous?
Yeah, this was a beer that Ryan and I started brewing probably 10 years ago, and we brewed it and rebrewed it. We had an idea of what we wanted. We wanted this beer that was not too malty, not too sweet, not too hoppy, had all of the essence of what a good beer is without having any of them really get out of line. It's all about balance. And so we worked tirelessly rebrewing the Blonde over and over again, different hops, different barley, different timing, all different techniques, until we finally got it to where it is now. And that is a smooth, balanced beer that offers really interesting fruit notes as it warms up, a mild bitterness, no more bitter than any other light beer, which is the interesting part. It's also got some kick to it at 6%. It's definitely in that, puts it up into that craft beer echelon of people that are expecting to get more bang for their buck. They want a full-bodied beer, they want a full-flavored beer, and they don't want to drink water. So that's really where the Blonde is and what we always shot for, and it took several years to get it there.
Well, let's taste the Blonde. So this is the American Blonde from Aldous. It's one of my favorites. It's very easy drinking. It's great on a summer day. It's great on a nice cold day. But it's probably my favorite. It matches me and my lifestyle, being an American Blonde. So cheers.
Yep.
It's delicious. So we're here in the production area. Jason, can you talk about what goes into making that beautiful American blonde that you're drinking today?
Absolutely. So the whole process starts here in the milling room where we have our barley crusher. We put the bag, dump the bags of barley in. That's a two-roll miller, busts up the barley, doesn't mill it down into a powder, it actually just breaks the barley into little pieces. We don't want it to get too small. So from the barley crusher, it goes up the grain elevator into the grain hopper, and from that area, it drops into the mash tun, and that's where we're gonna start the brewing process. We add the crushed barley and water heated to a very specific temperature into the mash tun, which begins the mash process.
And when you talk about mash, what's going on in the mash?
So during the mash process, the temperature of the water is activating enzymes in the barley that began their activation during the malting phase of creating the barley, the malted barley. So we're reactivating those and we're converting the starches in the barley kernels into sugar.
Okay.
Once we're done mashing, then we start the Vorloft process. And that consists of we flush the first runnings off the bottom of the mash tun back over the top of the grain bed. That stops any small particles from flowing into the brew kettle. From there, then we begin the sparge process, which is trickling fresh hot water over the grain bed that we've created here. And what that does is it rinses the sugars off the barley, the crushed barley, so we're able to pump it over into the boil kettle. At this point, it's called sweet wort. So once we have all of our sweet wort in the boil kettle, we get the boil going. This is when we add our hops. And there's a couple different times you can add hops. You can add a bittering charge at the beginning, an aroma charge at the end, and all times in between to get different sort of hop profiles.
So this is where the flavor infusion begins.
Correct. This is where the balance is going to be, where you're going to add that nice bitter charge to balance the sweetness, because the sweet wort it tastes like the sweetest tea you've ever had. The hops are added to counterbalance that sweetness and add aroma and flavor. So once we've added the hops, we now have what's called bitter wort, still not beer. From the boil kettle, we pump the now bitter wort through a heat exchanger, which drops it from about 190 degrees to 69 degrees in a matter of seconds. And from there, it's pumped into one of the fermentation vessels.
And those are the ones right here behind you.
Big tanks, yep. We got these and we're about to put in two more double-sized tanks probably in the next 2 weeks or so as we're getting into wholesale. We find that we need more space. So once we get into the fermenter, we add our yeast and cap it off. And usually before we're halfway done the cleaning process, we're getting some bubbles out of our blow-off buckets, which I don't know if we have any that are active. If we do, I'll show you one. But what it is, it's the yeast are getting happy in there. They're eating the sugar, and they're blowing off a lot of CO2. It's actually enough pressure to blow from the top down through a bucket of water. There's so much CO2 pressure that's created during the first couple days of fermentation. Once fermentation is finished, we then can take it to the finishing side of the brewery. We have our medical grade filter. We can either choose to filter the beer for a clear product like the blonde, or there's other techniques of refining the beer that don't use the filter. And from there it goes into the finishing tank.
And that's here on the left.
That's a little short guy right there. That is where we're gonna add the CO2. We have a special device called a carbonation stone. We squeeze the CO2 through there. It makes the CO2 particles really small and allows the beer to more easily absorb the carbonation. And then from there, we either keg it or take it over to our bottling line.
Okay, well let's go over and take a look at the bottling line.
Okay.
So we have the bottling line over here. So this is where you help bring beer to the masses.
Right, so right now what we're doing is we're finishing up a bottling run we did yesterday. We have our bottling line right here, which is actually will fill, cap, and rinse the bottles. And usually we send it off through the conveyor. We're doing things a little differently today. So right now what we're doing is finishing the bottles by running them through the labeler and packing them onto the cases to go on pallets.
Okay, so we're bottling today the American Blonde.
Yep.
What we're drinking today.
Absolutely. But from this, it usually goes on a pallet and gets ready to go out.
Well, Jason, you have a number of beers here and it looks like you pretty much have something for everyone. You know, what types of beers do you carry for our viewers out there so they know they might have something on tap, or you might have something on tap that they might like?
Yeah, well, yeah, you're right. We do have something for everybody. We do start with the simpler beers in the blonde, and actually if we go through our flagships from the blonde to the aromatic to the wee, they actually get darker and more complex as they go down. And then we get into some more, you know, we definitely like to have a nice hoppy regimen for the hop heads out there that want a nice hoppy IPA. We offer some darker beers. We have some big old beers, our Red Rye, which is one of my favorites besides the blonde.
If our viewers are interested in stopping by here at Aldis, can you talk about your hours, when you're open, and when they can come in and taste all of your beers?
Absolutely. We usually say as long as the door's open, we're open. The actual pub hours are Wednesday through Saturday. Wednesday through Friday, it's 3 to 9. We're trying to get those hours changed to 11. We're working on that with the Penn Township Board. We're open Saturday from noon to 9. We're hoping to get that changed from noon to 11. Other than that, if the door's open and you'd like to come in and try a sample, or you want to get a growler filled or a crowler filled or pick up a case, we're always, if the door's open, we're here. You're welcome to come in.
So if the door is open, there's beer.
Yep.
Well, thank
Pretty
you.
Much.
Thank you so much, Jason,
no problem,
for
Kate.
Having
thank
us
you.
Here today. And again, viewers at home, there are many options for every beer drinker, or even the non-beer drinker here at Aldis. Thank you so much for joining us today. Hi, we just left Aldis Brewing Company, and now we're in downtown Hanover here on the square with co-owner and founder of Miscreation, Mark Mathias. Mark, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you. Welcome.
Well, I asked Jason where they came up with the name Aldis in the last visit. And so where did you guys come up with the name Miscreation?
Well, it was one of those just goofy words that popped out of our mouths. We were thinking of doing a lines of the name of the business and like Monster, because Brent comes up with some very unique concoctions. And one day we were making a beer and he's like, man, that's just a crazy miscreation. And we were looking for a word that had an M in it to stand for Matthias and an S in it to stand for Stanball, and it was one of those words that just popped out, and it was one of those words you slept on for a couple days, and the more you said it, the more it was like, it didn't tie us into any specific realm, you know, miscreation. You can expand it as far as you want, because anything can be a miscreation.
So you can make any beer you'd like under miscreation.
Or artwork, you're not, you know, if you do Monsters, well, now you gotta do Monsters all the time. Well, miscreation, we do what we want now.
Well, and we're actually sitting in a beautiful piece of artwork here. And so behind us, these are skateboard tiles.
Yep,
correct?
It's like 89 broken skateboards cut down into perfect square rectangles, and Rich, the owner of artaboard.com, we were in here painting right after we took over the building and heard about us on the news, and this big tall guy just walked in one day while we were painting and introduced himself, and he's actually here in Hanover as well, and he was like, I want to do a piece for you guys. He goes, it's just the vibe, the building, the location, the energy. He goes, I want a place where my stuff's seen, and you see, he came in one day, and here it is. Well, it's a pretty cool project. The kids and the wives and everybody got to go over and help lay out the colors and pick out the pictures and stuff.
So speaking of collaborations, it wasn't just a family collaboration. You're collaborating with other downtown businesses.
Yep.
Really, this downtown resurgence, it's something special.
Yeah.
And I've seen it with not just Miscreation, but some other local businesses. And one of the events that I know you've been very, very supportive of and integral in making sure it happens is Sip and Stroll.
Yeah, we have Sip and Stroll is one of the one events I'm more prouder of to be a part of. Main Street Hanover really did a great job of creating a vibe. The cool thing about Sip and Stroll is it brings people in from outside of downtown that might not have ever been here, or, you know, come down and see what new is going on, you know, and also it gets you to go into shops that you might not even realize what they deal in. You know, you just drive by them on a busy day. And it shows the rest of the community, the people that are driving through downtown those days, that there's street life. There's a vibe going on the square. There's people moving around. There's people getting back out, that there's just cool things happening. I mean, we have Timeline Arcade now, Us, Something Wicked. We have Divino's. The Circle is really done a resurgence, and you see a lot of the businesses opening up and stepping outside of their box now from what their normal footprint originally was, with, you know, redoing their shops a little bit, adding maybe a little bit more eclectic decor, you know what I mean, just We have foot traffic now, which is where we need to start getting to. So besides just Dutch Days.
So our viewers at home, they can come here and get a beer. Yep. What are your hours, Mark?
Our hours right now are Monday through Thursday, 4 o'clock until 11. Okay. Friday, Saturday, we are open at 11:30 in the afternoon until last call is 12:30, and Sunday is 11:30 to last call is 5:30, and we close at 6.
And so here in downtown Hanover, you can come here and grab a beer, and you can go over across the street and grab a slice of pizza over at Divino's, go over to the Timeline Arcade, and you can really make a downtown night of it.
Yep, well, absolutely.
Something special about downtown, and we're so happy that Miss Creation has decided to locate here in downtown. It's helping with our downtown resurgence through our Main Street program, and we can't wait to see what's to come next. Well, we're upstairs at the bar here at Miss Creation with co-owner and head brewer Brent Stambaugh. And what beer are you pouring for us here today, Brent?
Today we're pouring a new beer. It's from our Hit or Miss series. It's a trial beer. We're trying to see what we can do with all these hops that were coming out now, and you know, we're just trying new beers with them.
So if it's a hit, it's a hit. If it's a miss,
it goes away.
It goes away, but if it's a hit, it becomes an official Miss Creation.
Yeah, and we will make it again, and we will, you know, play with it a little bit to see if we can get exactly what we want out of it.
Well, let's hope this one is a hit. So it can become a miscreation. Brent, thank you so much for joining us here today. I appreciate you and Mark letting us in to see all of your miscreations. And now we're going to go over to your neighbor, Something Wicked, and see what's on tap over there. So we're here at our next stop on our Hanover Brewery Tour, and we are here at Something Wicked with one of the partners, Jim Staub. Jim, thank you so much for joining us here today.
You're always welcome. Thank you.
Well, thank you. So Something Wicked is really a collaboration of a number of people. Can you talk about how Something Wicked came to be and the impetus behind the name?
Well, there's six partners. Lois, Cindy, Bill Sadler and his wife Bridget, Steve Benzow, and Scott Preveris. And we all got together. We volunteered through the Parrot Heads, and we vacationed together in the Outer Banks. And lo and behold, we all brought our home brews. We're all home brewers, and we ended up down there, and everybody had their own beer they brought along that they crafted in their basements or cellars or garages. So in the meantime, Steve, one of our partners, showed up. The bank was trying to liquidate this facility. It sat vacant for 7 years, and he tried to keep the auction going by raising his hand and submitting a bid. Well, he was the second bid and there was no third bid. So lo and behold, he bought the building sight unseen. This used to be an old moose lodge about 15 to 20 years ago. The moose, Hanover Moose, was located here. And so we looked at the commercial kitchen and we said, hey, we could consolidate our home brews, you know,
right,
and do it here.
Right here in one spot. So is that where the kitchen was here, back where the brewing location is?
Yes, that's correct. And we modified a little bit. We replaced the floor for some of the heavy equipment that we have, you know, since we've grown a little bit. But yes, so there we started brewing our 5 gallon batches. And lo and behold, of course, you can't make beer without tasting beer. You need to do research. So we looked out through this window and said, we could make a brew pub here. So one thing led to another, and we started the process.
So then Something Wicked was born, and you have a number of beers in the Something Wicked theme.
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about some of the beer names and how you came up with those names?
Well, we play the saints and sinners, you know, good and bad. We have chaos, we have sinful.
Can you talk a little bit about how charity came to be and your dedication to those local organizations?
Yes, well, my wife mostly still brews at home. We still brew 5 gallon batches at home. And her cousin, Diana Klunk, runs the boutique for ladies, you know, recovering from cancer, and she was relocating her business, and she asked her cousin Cindy if she could brew a beer for the event, the special event. So these people, most of them are, you know, Miller Lite drinkers, you know, Bud Light drinkers. So Cindy developed this recipe. It was sort of like to get non-craft beer drinkers into craft beer. So it was a light, refreshing beer, and it went over so well that we put it in the regular rotation here. And we take a dollar from every pint that we sell, and it goes into a special account. Like most businesses, we get regular requests for to help out various organizations, so we have a set aside account that we've you know, used that money for. So,
well, I can't thank you enough for your dedication to the community through charity, through all of your beers in your business, and your dedication to downtown Hanover in buying a building, rehabilitating it, and really being a great downtown business. So Jim, thank you so much. Thank you for having us here today, and we really appreciate everything that you do for the beer industry.
Well, thank you. We have a supporter. We know we can always count on you when we need help. So
thank you, Jim. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Hi, we're here at our last stop today with one of the co-owners of Warehouse Gourmet. Keith and his wife Melinda own Warehouse Gourmet here, and it's a mix of food and beer and good times, Keith.
Yep, absolutely.
So why did you pick the Warehouse? Why this particular location in Hanover?
Well, let's see, I purchased the Warehouse in 1996 as a place to live and as my art studio. When we started the restaurant, I actually didn't know what my role was going to be, because I'm an artist and a painter, and Melinda has all the knowledge of running a restaurant, working in a restaurant. I never worked in a restaurant before, but long story short, I told her I wanted to bake bread, and she kind of laughed at me and said that might be way over your head. It takes years to learn to bake. So she actually bought me a book from Ollie's on baking, and I created a sourdough starter with just flour, water, and a pound of red grapes. And a week later, things started happening, and the culture started working. So I've had that culture for over 11 years. It's the same sourdough culture. It's just flour and water and the wild yeast. And you feed it twice a day, and it stays happy, and you use it to mix in with the you know, the bread dough, and it gives it a great flavor, and it's actually a natural preservative.
I think it makes your sandwiches.
Absolutely, yeah, I think so too.
So you make everything here in house, from your beer to your desserts and mm-hmm. everything in between.
Yep.
So what's your favorite thing on the menu?
Oh goodness, which child do you love the most? Any of our sandwiches. I love our chicken tenders.
Your chicken tenders, they have a special crust on them.
Yes.
A special breading.
Yes. It's a potato chip crust, and the rest is proprietary, so I'll stop right there.
But it's an ode to our Hanover snack food
heritage.
Absolutely.
The chips come from Hanover, from Utz.
And that's what makes them extra special.
Yes.
And then you add some other special touches.
Well, they're baked. They're not fried like
baked.
A lot of things.
Oh.
So we don't deep fry anything.
So everything is baked, very healthy, and I know you make a really strong effort of trying to source local.
Absolutely. The spent grain from our brewery actually goes to a local farm where they use that spent grain and feed it to their cattle. And we buy a lot of beef from John, the guy that takes our spent grain.
Oh, so you can drop off your grain and see where your beef's coming from.
Absolutely.
All in one stop. And
yeah.
I think that's really important. I think people, especially in this area, want to support local farmers.
Sure.
Know where their food is coming from. And so if you have a dinner here or a lunch here, you know, because
yeah.
you're out there, you're picking up the meat from the butcher, and you know where it's coming
right,
from.
Right, right.
And I saw outside, I know it's a little cold since it's winter, but outside, you actually have your own little, your outside garden.
Yeah, yeah, we Melinda grows a lot of herbs that we use every day. My parents have land out in the Pigeon Hills that we, see last year we grew like 40 tomato plants, different varieties. Some heirloom tomatoes, some regular beefsteak type tomatoes, cherry tomatoes.
So for sandwiches and salads.
Yeah.
So everything from, you know, your delicious cheesecakes to your salads with a balsamic dressing, to your sandwiches, to your flagship dinners. Everything you do here is fantastic. Keith, thank you so much for being here today.
Oh, you're welcome. Thanks for coming.
Your dedication to our local community and really trying to keep things local.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm here with Gerald, one of the Warehouse Gourmet's bartenders. And Gerald, can you talk about this new bar that we've got downstairs here at Warehouse Gourmet? This is a new creation of Melinda and Keith's with the passage of Act 39. Now here in Pennsylvania, our local brewers can sell Pennsylvania distilled spirits. And so that's what we've got going on down here, right?
Yes.
And so what are some of the drinks that you're now serving and some of the liquors that you're using from Pennsylvania?
Well, of course you know that all the alcohol is from Pennsylvania. So we're using the Pennsylvania spirits to create new drinks, like one is mojitos.
We're going to be making G's Mojito.
Yes.
So G's Mojito, what all is in G's Mojito?
Well, I use some fresh lime. So the limes are cut up small. They put in the glass using about one lime.
One lime.
For a mojito. Fresh mint.
Fresh mint, which you guys grow here on site. Most of the herbs are used here locally.
Most of the herbs are used locally from the farmers around. So a few twigs of
fresh mint,
and we use our own sugar water.
This is made in-house sugar water.
This is made in-house sugar water. It is then squashed.
All right.
Yes. We're so very careful.
Everything comes together here,
everything,
all the flavors.
That the lime, the sugar water, and the mint. We use crushed ice, which is very important, than the regular using ice cubes. This is then topped off Pennsylvania rum.
Pennsylvania rum.
Okay, so there'll be 1.5, which is then topped off with tonic water.
Oh. Little splash.
Splash of tonic water. Stirred. Get it mixed. And the secret is Mr. Tester sauce.
Liam Perrin's Worcestershire sauce.
Yes. 2 drops. And voila. You have a
the mojito.
Yes.
Thank you. You're cheers. That's good.
Good.
Thanks, G. Thank you so much for joining us today on our trip throughout Hanover as we visited 4 different breweries. Each and every one has their own unique aspect of their business, whether it's a specialty brew, whether it's dedicating some of their profits to charity, or here at Warehouse Gourmet, making sure that all of those hungry bellies are fed. We appreciate their dedication to our local community, to making sure that they try and source local wherever possible. And we appreciate their continued commitment to downtown Hanover and economic development here in Pennsylvania. Thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you soon.